Hello friends, I am Dr. Bhumir Chauhan. I am consultant neurophysician at Ahmedabad, and today we will be discussing on peripheral neuropathy and its management. We will see what are the different types of neuropathy, what are the symptoms of neuropathy, what are the reasons that somebody has neuropathy, what are the tests we do for diagnosing it, and what are the treatment options which are available. But before proceeding to everything, let us first understand what a normal nervous system is. In human body, there is a central nervous system which is formed by brain and spinal cord. And this brain and spinal cord are connected to the end organs by another set of nerves which are called the peripheral nervous system. The peripheral nervous system consists of motor and sensory nerves. The motor nerve is the one which carries the signal from the brain towards the muscles, and it is responsible for muscle movements. The sensory nerves are those which carry the signals from the end organs like the skin, joints or bones towards the brain, and they are responsible for various sensory experiences that we have like the touch, pain, hot or cold temperatures. If we see the structure of a nerve, there is a thin wire or a small filament in between which is called the axon, and there is a protective layer which is surrounding it which is called the myelin. Depending on the content of myelin, the nerves are grouped as large fibers or the large nerves and small fibers or the small nerves. Generally speaking, the small nerves are responsible for the sensory function and larger nerves are responsible for the motor function. Any disease or any pathology which affects the function of these nerves is called a neuropathy. Now, what are the types of neuropathy? The types of neuropathy, they depend on various factors. Like for example, the location where it starts. It may start in the lower limbs, it may start in the upper limbs, or maybe all four limbs. Which are the type of damage which has happened to the nerve? Whether the axon is affected, it is called the axonal neuropathy. Whether the myelin is affected, it is called demyelinating neuropathy. And at times both are affected, it is called the mixed neuropathy. Patients may also have a sensory neuropathy where only sensory nerves are affected, or a motor neuropathy where only motor nerves are affected, and more commonly they have a combination of both, which is called the sensory motor neuropathy. It can also involve the small fibers called the small fiber neuropathy, or the large fibers called the large fiber neuropathy. Depending on the time course and the development of symptoms, neuropathy can be acute as well as chronic. We have got an example of an acute neuropathy called the Guillain-Barré syndrome or the GBS, where within matter of hours and days, the neuropathy is so rapidly progressive that the patient lands up with entire body paralysis and requires a ventilator. And on the other end of the spectrum, we have a diabetic neuropathy or a genetic neuropathy, which is very slow to develop, and it takes months or years for a patient to realize the symptoms. Also, neuropathy can involve only a single nerve in the body. It is called a mononeuropathy. And it may involve one or more nerves, it is called a polyneuropathy. Humans have a specific set of 12 cranial nerves which are supplying the face, and any pathology in these nerves is called a cranial neuropathy. Now let us understand the symptoms of neuropathy, what exactly the patient experiences and what exactly they report to a doctor. The symptoms of neuropathy depend on two aspects. First, which type of nerve is affected, whether it is a motor nerve or a sensory nerve or both of them. And second, in which body part has the disease process started, whether it is in the legs or the arms or both. If a patient experiences sensory neuropathy, the set of symptoms are called the sensory symptoms. The classical description of these symptoms is burning, tingling, numbness, paresthesias, cotton wool like sensations or insect bite like sensations. Also, patients develop imbalance in walking, especially when they walk on uneven surface or on a dark environment. Classically speaking, these symptoms, they start from the feet, especially at the sole of the feet. They gradually involve the upper part of the feet and proceed towards the knees. And then they start at the tips of the fingers and then involve the entire arm. This pattern of involvement is called the gloves and stocking pattern, and it is very classical of sensory neuropathy. If somebody develops a motor neuropathy, then the symptoms are related to muscle weakness. In the feet, they will have difficulty in walking, they will have slippage of chappals, they have difficulty holding their chappals while walking, They have difficulty putting their feet inside the chappals. They have multiple tripping falls. They have difficulty in getting up from sitting or squatting position, especially using the Indian toilets. And they have difficulty in climbing up or down the stairs. In the hands, they have difficulty in doing small and fine movements in the form of buttoning or unbuttoning a shirt, tying or untying a knot, holding a pen for writing, holding a cup of tea or a glass of water, or opening or closing the lids of a jar. If it is involving the arms, then patients will have difficulty in clearing the objects from the higher shelf, or maybe difficulty in combing or maybe drying the hair. It is important to understand that patient may have one or more of these symptoms, and more commonly they have a combination of sensory as well as motor symptoms. We already discussed about cranial neuropathies. In cranial neuropathies, the most common type that we see is the facial palsy. The seventh nerve on the face is responsible for the muscle movements of the face. So if left or the right facial nerve is affected, patient will have a half face paralysis on that particular side, and that is known as a facial palsy. Another nerve called the trigeminal nerve is the fifth nerve, and that is responsible for the sensations over the face. So whenever the trigeminal nerve is affected, patient experiences shooting and stabbing pain, or like a current-like pain, which is involving a particular part of the face. More commonly, this pain gets triggered by a touch, or maybe a shaving, maybe a gasp of air, or maybe a splash of water, or chewing, or even talking. And in some cases, it starts spontaneously without any triggers. This sort of disease is called the trigeminal neuralgia. Now let us come to the causes of neuropathy. Why somebody develops a neuropathy? It is important to understand that nerves are very, very vulnerable to a variety of problems. Those leading to its blood supply problems, those dealing with the problems of oxygen or nutrient supply, those dealing with the various drugs or maybe toxins in the blood, they are all capable of producing a neuropathic disease. Also, it is essential to see that certain group of patients or certain group of people, they have this inhalatory weaker nerves. The nerve structure is weak because of maybe a genetic makeup, because of another disease like a diabetes or thyroid, or a vitamin deficiency, or a long-standing malnourishment, or maybe chronic alcoholism. These are the subset of patients which are very prone or very vulnerable to develop a peripheral neuropathy, because the baseline structure of the nerve is weaker. So if we see, there are hundreds of causes of peripheral neuropathy, and I will be enlisting only a few important amongst them. The first we shall talk about is metabolic cause. Out of metabolic cause, the most important one is the diabetes. Diabetes can involve any nerve in the body, right from the head down to the toes. It is known as a diabetic neuropathy. Diabetic neuropathy can develop even before the onset of diabetes in the blood reports or in the other symptoms. It can develop during the course of diabetes and in the advanced stages of diabetes. Apart from diabetes, thyroid, liver, and kidney disease also can develop peripheral neuropathy. Neuropathy can also commonly occur because of vitamin deficiencies, especially vitamin B12, folic acid, and thiamine. Thiamine deficiency is very commonly seen in those who are chronically alcoholic, those who have undergone gastric bypass surgeries, those who have got chemotherapeutic agents, and so on. Another set of cause is infections. HIV, hepatitis B, herpes, leprosy, syphilis. These are the common causes which affect peripheral nerves and lead to peripheral neuropathy. Traumatic neuropathy. We always hear that certain bone was fractured during a case of accident or a trauma. There are so many nerves which run around these bones. And whenever there is a case of trauma, apart from the bones and other organs, nerves also get affected. And this is known as traumatic neuropathy. Another important disease leading to neuropathy is cancer. Cancer by itself can lead to peripheral neuropathy, that is known as paraneoplastic neuropathy. Also, the treatment given for cancer, the chemotherapeutic agents, they produce peripheral neuropathy as a side effect. Apart from anti-cancer drugs, there are certain other drugs as well, and there are certain toxins like lead or arsenic which can lead to peripheral neuropathy. In peripheral areas, the farmers, they use these pesticides, the organophosphate compounds. They are also an important cause of neuropathy in India. We also have a special subset of neuropathy known as the immune-mediated neuropathy. We know autoimmune disorders are the ones where the body's own immunity starts targeting the body organs. So if this immune system starts damaging the peripheral nerves, it leads to immune-mediated neuropathies. And the prime example of it is GBS or the Guillain-Barré syndrome. In a small proportion of patients, we also see genetic component to neuropathy called the genetic neuropathies. And in old age specifically, at times there are no causes which are identifiable and they are known as idiopathic neuropathies. So all in all, if we see the most common cause of peripheral neuropathy, if we say it is diabetes, and maybe vitamin deficiencies because of malnourishment, alcoholism or other disorders. Now let us see what are the tests which are required to be done in a patient with peripheral neuropathy. Before proceeding to the test, the first thing which we neurologists do when a patient comes with neuropathic pain symptoms is to take a detailed history. The detailed history will tell us about the type of nerves which are affected, and maybe a possible reason in the patient's background in the history, which can lead to the cause of peripheral neuropathy. We also do a complete physical examination to identify the deficits or the damage which are there in the nerves, and also make an attempt to establish a pattern of peripheral neuropathy. After history and examination, the first test which is required to be done is called the nerve conduction study. Nerve conduction study is nothing but a graphical image of a nerve. The nerve is stimulated with a very small microcurrent and it forms a graph which is recorded. The shape and pattern of the graph tells us about the possible damage and the degree of damage in that particular nerve. Nerve conduction study is very useful so as to identify the pattern of neuropathy, to estimate the damage in neuropathy, also to know the type of damage, whether it is an axonal damage or a demyelinating damage. Depending on these data, it is important for us to know that which are the tests are required in further classification and to identify the cause of neuropathy, and also it helps us in identifying the possible prognosis, as in what is the time which will be required for that patient to recover and what are the estimated drugs or the doses of the drugs which will be required to cure the patient. So all in all, if we see, nerve conduction study is the most important test that a peripheral neuropathy patient will have. And it is the first step before proceeding on to the other steps. Once the nerve conduction study is done, we have an idea of narrowing down the blood tests which are required. The blood tests and other tests are done in stage-wise manner. The first stage is the routine blood test which we do, like the hemogram, liver and kidney functions, thyroid, diabetes and vitamin testing. If negative, we proceed on to the next level of testing, where we see for immune-mediated disorders, or a genetic cause, or maybe a cancer-related diagnosis. If negative, then the final stage comes where we go for interventional studies in the form of CSF analysis by doing a lumbar puncture study, by doing a nerve biopsy or a skin biopsy. And nowadays, MRI and ultrasonography of peripheral nerves is also performed. The main focus or the main target of doing all these investigations is to find out the ultimate cause which has led to the peripheral neuropathy. Now let us see the treatment options available for peripheral neuropathy. The treatment of neuropathy can be broadly categorized into two parts. One, which is called the symptomatic management, and the other, which is the treatment of the cause of neuropathy. There are certain targets which we set before the initiation of treatment. The first target is symptom relief. The patient should be made comfortable. Second target is to identify the cause of the neuropathy. Third target is to see whether that cause is a progressive one, whether it is going to go bad in coming days or months. And in that case, we have to stop the progression of the disease. And finally, to look for any relapses or recurrences. Once the neuropathy is cured, we have to make sure it doesn't come up again. So the cause of the neuropathy will decide whether there are relapses or recurrences which are going to happen or not. And if so, we have to use treatment for a longer term, even after the neuropathy is cured, so that the relapses or recurrences do not happen. The first step, the symptom management. It is very important from patient point of view. We use medicines to control the neuropathic pain. Neuropathic pain is very bothersome and very troublesome for the patient. It interferes with the daily activities, it interferes with the sleep as well. And after a certain point of time, it starts playing on the mind and leads to mood changes, irritability, and in some cases, it can also lead to depression. For control of neuropathic pain, there are various medicines which are available. The most common ones which we use are pregabalin, gabapentin, nortriptyline, amitriptyline, duloxetine, carbamazepine, lamotrigine, etc. Apart from medicines, we also have topical agents which are used in the form of gels, and they include lignocaine, capsaicin and gabapentin. Treatment of pain or the treatment of neuropathic pain is only the half job done. It is not the actual treatment of neuropathy. The actual treatment of neuropathy is to identify the cause and treat it. So the treatment of cause can be broadly categorized as medical management and surgical management. Under medical management, we give treatment for diabetes, thyroid, liver or kidney disorders. We provide vitamin supplementation in the form of tablets or injections. Patient may require antibiotics or antiviral drugs for infection-related neuropathies, anti-cancer drugs for cancer-related neuropathies. For inflammatory or immune-mediated neuropathies, steroids are used. And in certain cases, which are rapidly progressive, like the GBS, we use plasma exchange or IVIG as a rapid modality of treatment. In the surgical aspect, there are compressive neuropathies, where the nerve is pressed by a tumor, by a bony outgrowth, or like a slip disc, and they will require a surgical intervention. In carpal tunnel syndrome, the median nerve is compressed at the wrist by a soft tissue. So there are surgical options which are available where a small cut is put into this tissue and the compression is relieved. In patients of trigeminal neuralgia who do not respond well to medications, a microvascular decompression surgery is advisable to get a pain relief. And in patients who have got a solid tumor which has led to neuropathy, the resection of the tumor by doing a surgery is required. So that is all regarding peripheral neuropathy and its management. I'm sure the information on neuropathy will be useful to you as well as your family to understand this disease. If anyone you feel develops such symptoms, please do consult a doctor and get properly investigated to find out the cause. Thank you.